Okay, well, thank you so much. So I'll be covering 20 years of transports and a little bit of collections, but mostly transports. And I will have to go a little fast. I have a lot of slides, but then we'll have some time for questions and there's coffee breaks and everything. So, okay, so let me start by saying I'm immensely proud to be sitting here with these wonderful people. I mean, I was ordering fish from these guys when I was back at the Oceanari, where I started my career, learning all the tricks of the trade with Mark Smith and Alan sitting right there. And to be up here, you know, at this table with these guys, with Dynasty and Cairns, it's just, I'm up in the clouds. And I also have to say that, well, this presentation, of course, is about transports and the history of transport. It is a little flying sharks centered, as much as I try to cover other bases. But I like to think that our methods of transport, even though we're based in the third and a half world, are pretty much the same as everybody, what everybody else is doing. So there we go. So that's us back in 98. Moving fish to the Oceanari, you will recognize the handsome men on the right there, sitting right over there, João Falcato, we were colleagues back at the Oceanari. Now, what I think is really cool is that back in those days, we were moving 747s, just like Forrest was telling us yesterday, filled with fish. We didn't have an oxygen probe, no pH probe, there was no concept of bicarb and carb and everything, there was no AmQuel, and we were all just happily looking at these tanks and the fish and moving them and keeping them alive. Now, those were the days where we would have some collectors. The philosophy was bring your own tank transports. We would have to build everything ourselves, which is really not that bad. You know, it gave us an opportunity to develop our woodcraft techniques and everything. And I also developed my wonderful sense of style. I was wearing suspenders and a belt because I'm that careful about stuff. And then came Forrest. So we had some, less pleasant experiences, let's say, before with a certain collector that went to jail, I understand. But let's not go into that. And then Forrest came along and basically saved our proverbial asses and put together a massive order for the Oceanari, and of course the atmosphere just completely different, just the level of professionalism and the way these animals were caught, the way these animals were moved. But I can't help to think back, to look back and to think at how we were doing things back then. I mean, we were moving really big sharks in boxes with a pump shooting water in front of their mouth, and you know, they were surviving. We were getting them to their end destination alive and well, but things have evolved and have progressed quite a bit since then. We're moving some small hammerhead sharks. Ben, in fact, sitting right here, flew these from Hawaii. We all rendezvoused in Miami, and then we flew them to Lisbon and then to Rotterdam. And that was pretty basically the setup we had back in those days, you know, round tank, big oxygen cylinder with a strap and a couple of 12-volt batteries and a jacuzzi filter, and everything just seemed to work. I was very impressed at the time with the tanks that Dynasty had. They had these baffle plates, you know, to keep the water from sloshing. They also had the water would come out of the filter with like the sprinkler system to aerate it, which was really, really cool. And we actually copied that from you guys since. We were handling our sharks with our bare fingers, you know, 20 years ago, not a good idea. We could actually see the finger marks on their skin the day after, so not very good. Anyway. We were also collecting mackerel, and I did this for many, many months with Alan right there back in the south of Portugal. Now, I did not understand the concept of bending my knees, so I'm working diligently on my L5 S1 herniated disc, which is still with me today. We're good friends. Now, we moved quite a bit of fish back in those days, so the Oceanari, as you know, a wonderful, wonderful facility. I mean, if you guys haven't been there, I seriously encourage you to do so. But it does have four different habitats and a big-ass, big tank in the middle. But there's an Atlantic, Antarctic, Pacific, and Indian Ocean habitat, which means that we literally received animals from all over the world. So I gained a little experience moving animals, and at one point, the Valencia Aquarium in Spain basically asked if I could go and give them a hand. So we moved some animals from Forest to Valencia. Now, there's a couple of things I want to highlight for you guys here. Notice how we became a little more sophisticated here. We had those wooden crates or those frames protecting the oxygen cylinders, because of course if that oxygen cylinder falls, that wooden crate that wooden frame is going to protect it from destroying thing. And I particularly like these blue plastic tarps and the way they were just so wonderfully done. And notice that I'm there as well, so I'm not pointing fingers. I'm pointing fingers at myself. But I do like how the airlines would force us to have these blue tarps, because obviously if you're 39,000 feet up in the air, you have 1,000 gallons of salt water in a tank. If there's some sort of a leak, well, that blue tarp is going to save everybody. Now, at this point, we were using oxygen probes and pH, still not doing AmQuel and pH buffers. That came just a couple of years after. But we were actually monitoring the animals. And we were moving sharks in a round tank. We were basically using really big tanks with smaller sharks. And I think that pretty much became the norm. It's very rare for the big rectangular tanks to be used these days. I'm actually inside that tank giving dexamethasone to a sandbar shark, to Carcharhinus plumbeus, or plumbeus in Latin. And that shark survived, and that was great. Now, then flying sharks came along. Our very first order to Valencia, no less. It was this cute little devil ray, Mobula Mobular, that we drove to Valencia. We were very, very panicky, our very first order. So we were very careful. We didn't want the filtration, all the pumps and the hoses in front of the ray's cephalic lobes. So we came up with this clever system where all of the filtration was in a separate tank. And then a couple of pumps would return the water back into the main ray tank so that it wouldn't have any obstacles. So that's us arriving to Valencia, vet inspection on arrival, and the devil ray just swimming happy. Now, these slides are actually from the RAW 2009 meeting. I had this wonderful template back in those days with those beautiful blue lines. This was the rage back in 2009. And see how proud we were of these road transports. You know, we had our round tanks with the filters and oxygen, and you know, we were super happy. We also moved some sunfish at the time to Atlanta. In fact, Forrest not only mentioned this yesterday, but some of the water, we did a water change at JFK when we flew in with these tanks, and the water was actually provided by Forrest, because that plane you see in the back flew from Florida to JFK to then move the sunfish to Atlanta, and it flew with some water from Forrest. And the reason I'm saying this is, it's really, really cool that, you know, you could think that the three of us are competitors. Well, we're not. We're really not. We were in three completely distinct parts of the world. We basically, whenever I get an order for Caribbean fish, I forward that to Ben. Whenever I get an order for Indian Ocean Pacific fish, I forward that to Laura. And we pretty much work in collaboration, which is really, really cool. And we really help out each other. Now, notice the water quality back at the RAW 2009, and you can just see that pH, the blue lines, is just declining. It doesn't really matter how much AmQuel, which is for ammonia, obviously, but sodium carb and bicarb that we're adding into that water, that pH was just hard to keep. So this was 10 years ago, and we kind of knew what we were doing. We weren't losing animals in transit, but we were still having a hard time keeping things under control. Then we got this wonderful order for boxes from Beth sitting right there. I just noticed that the date is wrong. It's actually 2008. But I really want to thank Beth for ordering fish from a bunch of crazy kids that really didn't know what the hell they were doing. So she went out on a limb for us, and I really want to thank her for that. That holding facility you saw right there, that was actually at the school where I teach. It's in Peniche. It's 1 hour north of Lisbon. So all of Flying Shark staff pretty much is my students or former students. And we all went out there and we got pizza and beer and we went collecting and diving. We didn't have custom-made boxes back in those days. We would buy them from our local Home Depot. You can tell that the size wasn't really right, so we had a lot of newspaper wrapping in there. And I also want to apologize to Beth for the newspaper, because we do have some naughty pages. And I'm sure...
Great.
I'm sorry. I just want to formally apologize for what we probably put you through back in those days. Sorry. Anyway. And let me just say that I added those black lines about 15 minutes ago. And I thought, nah, I just don't wanna. Okay. So then 2010, we made this, we had this wonderful charter, and of course, both Dynasty and Cairns are no strangers to charters. I mean, these guys have done over the years all over the world, Asia, everything. So we did two planes to Istanbul. We were quite proud of that. And we came up with quite a few new interesting solutions. First of all, the fish were kept in mainland Portugal, in Peniche, where I teach, and also in the south, where you saw us collect mackerel. But the bulk of the order was actually in the Azores. And Rui is sitting right there. He manages our station in the Azores. He was keeping these fish with his team in 40-foot shipping containers outside for 3 or 4 months, doing water changes. And those shipping containers were then taken and put on a ship, on a vessel, and Rui drove it all the way to Lisbon. And he did a wonderful job. That's Rui on the right there, just in case you guys can't tell. But it looks very a little different now than he did back in those days. So we came up with some cool solutions to do water changes. We had this interesting valve system on each of the tanks that allowed us to basically drain all the tanks at once. Well, not completely, but partially. And then fill all the tanks at once while we're out on the ocean. So that really made life a little easier. Now, the tank design back in those days was a little better. Just better filtration, but still working on the 12 volts. But notice the little cylinder for the oxygen cylinder right there. So things were just a little better. We actually had these little rings so that the straps would go through them. That doesn't sound like much, but it actually makes a huge difference when you're strapping round tanks to an aircraft. And of course, protein skimming. That's when we started to actually use protein skimming back in those days, and it has made a world of difference in our water quality throughout transports, and I will go into that a couple more times. So, very quickly, again, now at this point we were doing oxygen probes, pH, and doing AmQuel, doing pH buffers. That's us moving some bull rays to Nausicaa. That, pretty much the same standard process, doing it by road. That's when we learned that truck drivers have to rest for 9 hours every now and then. And we never made that mistake again. Now we have multiple teams scheduled throughout the trip. And then in 2013, we started the Aquário de Porto Pin. That's an aquarium in the Azores. Rui, again, is based over there, and that makes things a lot easier for us. And I'm going to play for you a short little video, and I'll just talk over it. That's us moving some black tip sharks from Seville in the south of Spain to Zumarine in the south of Portugal. And I'll just, again, it just illustrates the whole process of dosing the water with sodium carb, sodium bicarb, with AmQuel. We actually did that loading at night because it was July and it was 43 degrees Celsius at midnight. That's like 110 Fahrenheit, give or take, I believe. So that's us moving the sharks. And I'm getting a little late on my time, so I'm just going to go ahead and fast forward that, because then we introduced them and we've all done that. So then we moved along huge catfish to Allen, to Springfield. Rui again designed this amazing box. There's just so many details that I don't have time to go into. These amazing locks that Rui studied, that you have just enough force so you don't have to do all those annoying bolts when you arrive. So these locks, but he actually studied just how many and how strong they needed to be. A lot of detail went into that. That's the box getting shipped in Madrid, and then it flew to Chicago, and then it was driven down to Springfield. Then we moved some sharks, captive bred black tips, from Oberhausen in Germany to the Oceanario, and that was another game changer for us because we stopped using 12 volts. We started using inverters that basically convert the 12 volts from the van into 220 volts. We also use a refrigerated van that you see right there, and that basically allows for amazing water quality because you've got that stability. You've got the 220 volts throughout, and you fine-tune the protein skimmer at the beginning of the trip, and that's it. You pretty much don't need to change it throughout the trip. That's just water quality. I actually have a picture of the rough. I'm not going to go into the detail, but you can just see that pH is just nice. It's just nice and stable. It changes like a couple of centimeters or 100 decimals throughout the thing. But my mind escapes me sometimes. So then, of course, Forrest mentioned this yesterday. Airline regulations prevent us from using oxygen cylinders these days. So we're basically shipping these animals sealed. That's us moving a sunfish to Moscow. That's a taupe shark inside that tank being moved to Vienna. Got a 10-second video right here of that taupe shark on arrival. They used a really cool system to acclimate it to a little kiddie pool. That's it, taupe shark swimming in a kiddie pool in Vienna right there. Excellent. Moving right along. Boxes, boxes, boxes. Small tanks without oxygen, just a small aeration pump, the IATA Live Animal Regulation 60. We use that for rays mostly, and I think that's pretty much the norm. You guys are, you know, do that all the time as well. Big, big, big shipment again from sea, from a ship to the Azores to Lisbon. A lot of animals, 2,000 mackerel and a bunch of other things, sharks, rays, teleosts. They went to Königswinter, that's in Germany, and then a second stop in Stralsund. Now, the cool thing about this transport is that from the moment the first fish was loaded into the container, it was 11 days until the last fish was taken out, zero mortalities. And we're quite proud of that, and that, I think, shows that the systems that we're all using these days are vastly different than what we were all using 20 years ago. Feeding, you can't keep mackerel unfed for 11 days, so we actually fed them while at sea, and because you have a lot of water, you can do a lot of water changes, but it's a little harder to keep pH under control. But as soon as you get to shore and you drive to Germany, you don't feed anymore, and you can just see the difference in the pH is just a lot more stable. Istanbul, the guys from Madrid asked us to go get some rays from Istanbul. This was October last year. We got a swanky new truck. It's got our logo, and we're so proud of it. It says Live Sharks and Rays. It's amazing. Again, the inverter converting 24 volts, not 12, and this is important. You got to make sure your connections are done properly, two batteries in parallel, otherwise you fry the whole damn thing. And then we actually learned that when you rent a car in Turkey, you cannot drive it out of the country. So we actually rode the truck's cabin behind, and basically illegally, and we crossed the borders by foot. And I gotta tell you, it is such an amazing feeling to go into the European Union after you've been through hell in Turkey, and you basically rent the car and you just drive it wherever the hell you want. It's wonderful. And then we got a ferry, and we have to be very careful because we. On a boat, they give you 380 volts, and that's going to fry your filtration. So that's something we have to keep in mind on next time. And protein skimming, again. And let me just point out, look at that gunk that just accumulates there. Now think of after, you know, a day, you would basically dump that stuff back into the tank. I mean, that's crazy. That's crazy, right? So the protein skimming makes huge difference. And I'm nearly done here. And there's a detail on the left there. That's where we installed the inverter on that trip. And right next to where the cold air comes out of the truck. Not a good idea. Really cold air in front of a box filled with electronics. It's just stupid. So we learned that day the inverter broke. But we, even though we're Portuguese, we do have a backup for everything. So we had a generator. And that carried us throughout Spain. We had some refugees on the road. This is something that happens in that part of Europe. Just people, men, women, children, laying on the road, just trying to jump inside the truck. It was a little hairy. We had to call the police. I mean, I'm not going to go into it, but a little scary. We got to Madrid after 6 days in transit. We left Istanbul with 15 animals, and we arrived with 17, because two were born. And that's really cool. Okay, moving right along. Norway, David and I sitting right there and another guy, we moved 1,200 salmon smolt from an aquaculture. They actually asked us to do the smoltification process during the trip. And okay, I really gotta finish here. And we did that. And the good thing is that as soon as we raised the salinity just a little bit, the protein skimming started working. So it was virtually not working before, but as soon as we added a little bit of salt, it did start working, and that really made our minds appease. Norway is amazing. The Norwegians, you know, they also had 380 volts, but they came up with a way with the extension cords to give us 220, not like Turkey, but I'm not going to go into that. So look at that water quality. Look at that pH and how stable it is these days. With when you have just regular filtration, it gets to a point where we don't even need the sodium carbonate anymore, which is at the extreme of the buffering equation, if you'll remember your chemistry. So the bicarb alone will just keep your pH stable, just flat throughout the trip, and just compare that to what we had, you know, 10 years before. Very, very quickly, getting mackerel again. In Portugal, new method with some lovely pictures from an Hungarian photographer friend of mine. Now we don't do the plastic bags anymore. We do this stretcher that is basically hoisted by a crane. So a lot of mackerel swimming in that stretcher go into a tank. And that's it. And then this is me telling Alfredo I'm getting a little queasy. I got to get back to shore. We have enough mackerel. And that's us just looking at the mackerel. That's a Portuguese way of solving things. We just look at stuff and it fixes on its own. It works pretty good, actually. The crane is getting the mackerel out. I know I'm over time, but I'm really, really finishing up. And we got the forklift driving it to the holding station, and plastic bags to, you know, put it in the holding tank. And that's the guys packing the shark that went to Vienna. And a little shout out to Clem from 121 that we're using their equipment right there. And so we've come a long way, and this is a joke for the Guns N' Roses fans, so where do we go from here? And I will finish off with this amazing unit that Rui is developing. We started calling it a transport unit. Well, it's way more than that. It's a mobile holding station. Why would we limit ourselves to having filtration that keeps fish alive for a few hours or a few days? So this thing will basically keep fish alive forever. It's a holding station on wheels, and it can basically go anywhere in the world. And we can do all sorts of voltage, temperature controlled, can go by road or by sea. We can change whatever we want with the lighting, 17 cubic meters of water, amazing filtration, just kick-ass LSS. Everything is monitored automatically. We have a really cool partnership with the guys from Senai. I'm sure you guys are familiar with them. So everything is corrected and monitored, and likewise. And the video surveillance, it generates its own Wi-Fi signal. So we're in the car, in the back, looking at our phones, and we know pH, we know ammonia, we can see the fish swim, and it's pretty cool. And we got some funding. There's a lot of European funding that helps us. It allowed us even to buy a little coffee machine for all. So that's pretty cool. And I will finish off by thanking you all for your patience, thanking Clem for his enthusiastic pictures every time he gets my books. And I hope to see you all in the Azores, because tomorrow we will be bidding to host Raw in the Azores. So I just want to get your attention and hopefully get your votes tomorrow, because I have no shame. Thank you so much.